Correct, correct. I mean, he was a master at manipulating them out of the relationship. I mean, when he was tired of it or bored or whatever, he would fool around more and more blatantly. And finally, the woman would be provoked, whoever it was, would be provoked to leave him. So he seemed to have a need to always be in the right or cast himself as a victim in these situations.
Well, and he also juggled. He juggled them with one on one phone and one on another phone. It was interesting how I think there's one person who, Lee, I believe is her name, who discusses what Warren Beatty, the lover, was like. And that was an interesting part, too.
Yes. I mean, I had a lot of the women that I interviewed, and a lot of them have written about him, you know, in these books that, you know, sort of memoirs, which I call bimbographies, although some of them are quite good. And some of them, you know, a lot of them have written about his, you know, that aspect of him. And then I interviewed a few people. One woman had a long clandestine affair with him. It lasted, you know, a couple of years, and then an actress named Joyce Heiser, who was very forthcoming and very interesting about him.
Yeah, she even had Thanksgiving Day with his family.
Yes, she first met him as he was coming back from his father's funeral, and so she offered a very interesting perspective.
His films, as I said to you, I think Reds is one of the great films of all time. I do wonder, as you did the book, what was his Rosebud? Because there's a bit of him that Citizen Kane, Orson Welles type character.
That's a great question, which I have to think about. What was his Rosebud? You know, nobody's ever put it to me that way, and I haven't put it to myself that way. Mm-hmm. So I'm gonna put that one on hold.
All right. His working with, let's begin with the women he worked with, beginning with Bonnie and Clyde. Leslie Caron says she was the one who urged him to buy that. They were having a romance, and then he turned and looked at her and said, "You're too old for the part." Well, she also being French wouldn't have been right for an American part.
Well, he denies that he ever considered her, you know, and he said just what you said, that she was French, and the part calls from a woman from Texas, you know, or at least credibly a woman from Texas, and that's true that Leslie Caron makes no sense in that role. So,
again, interesting. In her book, she doesn't talk about Peter Hall suing and naming Warren as the adulterous correspondent, and that she lost her two children because of that. In your book, I discover that is what happened, and that Warren had to pay court suits.
Right, right. Cost, yes.
Yeah.
Court costs. Well, that was a difficult period for him, because he had a big success with Splendor in the Grass, and then he made a series of films which, you know, he put himself in the hands of the great directors of the era. You know, John Frankenheimer, Robert Rawson, Arthur Penn. And film after film after film flopped, and they weren't very good films. And
no.
At the same time, he was carrying on with, you know, he was blamed for breaking up Natalie Wood's marriage with R.J. Wagner, and then he was blamed for breaking up Leslie Caron's marriage with Peter Hall, and she had two children. So this persona, this profile that he built for himself publicly, of a Don Juan, of a lady killer, was backfiring because he was getting a lot of bad press. I mean, the British press treated him really harshly for breaking up Leslie Caron's marriage, even though both Caron and Peter Hall say that the marriage was on the rocks before she met Warren. If it hadn't been Warren, it would have been somebody else.
Which brings me to this great picture of meeting the Queen at a royal presentation. Leslie Caron is next to him. They are all looking at the Queen, but Warren is looking at Julie Christie.
That's
and
right.
The handwriting is on the wall there.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's about around the time that he first met Julie Christie. And Julie Christie became the woman for Warren. And that lasted, he and Julie lasted for 5 or 6 years. And it was a great matchup. And many people, you know, including
Heaven
myself.
Heaven Can Wait.
Yeah, Heaven Can Wait, Shampoo.
Yeah.
And he wanted her to do Louise Bryant in Reds, until, you know, they became so estranged, I don't think it would have worked. And then he met Diane Keaton.
When we were talking about Bonnie and Clyde, the way it was shot and the type of camera that was used and the light were phenomenal and very different. And the ending of that film, I saw that film in London, and as that came on, it almost the whole audience was dizzy. I mean, he had such an effect on that last bit of that film.
Well, yes, I mean, that was a watershed movie, you know, that helped to kick off the so-called New Hollywood of the 1970s. And, you know, it was innovative both technically and aesthetically, in the sense that, D.D. Allen's editing, the velocity of the film and how fast it moved, some of the jump cutting and the juxtaposition between violence and laughter, which a lot of the critics found very hard to swallow. And at the same time, it upended the moral code that had been enforced by the code for years, the moral order. In other words, the villains were the sheriff, the police, parents, you know, the older generation. And the film makes heroes out of bank robbers and killers. And that was scandalous at the time.
He never did a picture under budget. Everything always went longer than it was budgeted for. Which film made money?
Bonnie and Clyde made a lot of money. And of course, you know, just briefly, the story which is so extraordinary about that is that the studio dumped the movie, and the movie died, and Warren, just by dint of relentlessly pursuing them and badgering them, got them to reopen the movie, re-release the movie, and it did very well. It made a fortune. That movie made money. Shampoo made money. Heaven Can Wait made a lot of money. And Reds, it's hard to say whether it made any money or not. And Pat will probably never know. It's like squaring the circle what happened with Reds.
Ugsy drove him crazy. That the studio was not releasing it the way he wanted it, and that it wasn't, well, I guess it was Bugsy was just not being opened, or as somebody said, it skewed old.
Well, you know, first of all, it should be said that, you know, that directors and actors often blame the studios for the failure of the movie. Mm-hmm. Bugsy didn't fail, but it didn't do as well as they were expecting it to do. And it is, I think, an extraordinary movie, and probably Beatty's best performance. You know, there's some scenes in that movie that are absolutely indelible, and he really let himself go. And he was always a very restrained actor, almost embarrassed by acting. And he goes places in Bugsy that he never went before and never went since.
He didn't direct it, though.
He didn't direct it. Barry Levinson directed it, but Warren produced it.
Yeah.
And that was probably the sole instance where he hired a director and it worked out. Well, you know, that he and Levinson, and there was a triumvirate of he and Levinson and James Toback, who wrote the script. They all got along well, and there weren't those kinds of fights that marred a lot of his other movies.
Oh, I mean, who with Karen, who directed a film for him?
Love Affair, yeah.
And then again with Peter Chesholm.
Chesholm, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, both those movies were unfortunate experiences, and I think it's one of the people always ask me why and how did he become such a control freak? And I think one of the reasons is that whenever he did not control every aspect of the movie, Town and Country, he was just an actor. Mm-hmm. Everything went wrong, you know, and he regretted it. So I think he found himself in a situation where if he didn't direct and didn't produce. You know, he was risking his reputation.
By the time he did Town and Country, he was how old? 60?